Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to have a look at the laws of trigonometry in red geometry. The surprise is going to be that the laws of trigonometry in this new relativistic geometry are exactly the same as the laws of trigonometry that we're used to in ordinary Euclidean geometry. So our five main laws of trigonometry are going to hold exactly unchanged in this new setting. That's a great confirmation of the validity of rational trigonometry and also extends its domain considerably. So let me remind you that if we have three points in the plane, as usual, with coordinates x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, then the quadrances in the red setting between them are as follows. So the quadrants between a2 and a3 we call q1. And it's given by the square of the difference of the x-coordinates minus the square of the difference in the y-coordinates. So a lot like Euclidean geometry, except there's a minus sign here instead of a plus sign. Here are the other two quadrants, q2 and q3. Now this triangle also has three lines, and those lines make spreads. And we can describe those spreads in terms of vectors. So here's the vector a1, a2 from a1 to a2, and here's the vector a1, a3 from a1 to a3. Those two vectors have a spread. And the formula for the spread is this expression here. And it's very much the same as the familiar blue spread between two vectors, with following exceptions. There's a minus sign here instead of a plus sign. There's a minus sign here instead of a plus sign. There's a minus sign here where there's usually nothing. Okay, so there's three new minus signs. Otherwise, it's exactly the same as in blue geometry. And our key for establishing the main laws of trigonometry is to establish the most important one, the cross law, which is the relation between the three quadrances and one of the spreads. We'll choose S1. Okay, and here's the cross law, and it's exactly the same as the cross law that I hope you are very familiar with. Q1 minus Q2 minus Q3 all squared equals 4 times Q2 times Q3 times 1 minus S1. And I'm claiming that this is an identity that follows directly from the definition of S1 and the definition of these three quadrances. In other words, you could go off now and just crank out and check that the left-hand side equals the right-hand side when we substitute these three values, these four values. All right, but let's ourselves go through now and check why this is exactly the case. All right, I've started by writing 1 minus S1. So we have 1 plus that expression that we had on the previous page. And now I want to invoke that identity that I told you about last time that I said was important, that we can rewrite this using a Fibonacci-type identity by taking everything over the common denominator. This is the common denominator, putting it up there, and then rearranging the numerator to realize that it can be written this way, as x2 minus x1 times x3 minus x1 minus y2 minus y1, y3 minus y1 all squared. So that's the quantity that's appearing on the right side of the cross law. And here is the right side, 4 times Q2 times Q3 times this 1 minus S1. So the Q2 term is this expression right here, the quadrants between A1 and A3. And Q3 is exactly this expression, the quadrants between A1 and A2. So when we multiply this by Q2, Q3, these denominators here cancel. And we have 4 times just the numerator, all this quantity squared. So that's the right-hand side of the cross law. And here's the left-hand side of the cross law, Q1 minus Q2 minus Q3. There's Q1, and I've subtracted Q2, because there's a minus sign, there's a plus sign that appears there. And I've subtracted Q3. Again, there's a plus sign that appears there because there's a minus sign in Q3. And now we have this expression here, and just as in the video number 43, I believe, we simplify something like this, and we see that there's a lot of cancellation. And the things that don't cancel have twos in front of them, so there's a common factor of 2 that appears. And it's a good exercise to write this all out, see what cancellation appears, and convince yourself that what's left over can be written inside the brackets as x2 minus x1 times x3 minus x1 minus y2 minus y1, y3 minus y1. So this is the left-hand side of the cross law, and just as in the previous videos, we square this to get this. Two squares to get four, this quantity squares to get exactly that, and so this squared is equal to that, and we have a proof of the cross law valid for red geometry. And now let's see why this implies the other main laws of trigonometry. So one of the main points of videos number 42 and 43 was to convince you that all the laws of trigonometry follow from the cross law. That's the master law. Now, since we've just established this thing in red geometry, it follows that these other laws that we're familiar with are consequences and follow almost immediately in the red geometry too. So let me just run through that quickly. It's very familiar, and this is almost exactly what I've done in video number 43. Pythagoras' theorem. If S1 equals 1, in other words, if the two sides are perpendicular in the red sense, well, then this quantity over here becomes 0, and we see that Q1 equals Q2 plus Q3, and conversely. The triple quad formula. That's the case when the three points are collinear, or the spread between them is 0. If this is 0, then this squared equals 4 times Q2, Q3. That's one form of the triple quad formula. Now, rearranging this thing here, bringing the 4q2, q3, s1 term over to this side here, and bringing this part over onto the right side, we get this minus this, and that can be written in a way that's familiar to you now, I hope, as the sum of the q's all squared minus 2 times the sum of the squares. And this quantity here, which depends on the three quadrants of the triangle, we call the quadria of the triangle, denoted by A. Now, if we take this expression here and divide everything by 4q1, q2, q3, then we get s1 over q1 equals this. And then by symmetry, that's also the same as s2 over q2, also the same as s3 over q3. And that's the spread law. And finally, if we call this ratio 1 over d, then we can replace q1 with d times s1. And Q2 with D times S2, and Q3 with D times S3. We can plug that all into the cross law. And when we write that out and cancel all the D's, then we get a formula only involving the S's, and that's the triple spread formula. So the laws of trigonometry in relativistic sense are exactly the same as they are in Euclidean geometry. This is a very profound and important fact that allows us to transfer all kinds of information and geometrical insight from Euclidean geometry into relativistic geometry. Next time, we're going to have a look at how the geometry is shaped by the circles, in quotes, the red circles, in this relativistic geometry. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.